Welcome, everyone. Thank you for braving your hangovers and making it in today. So we're going to be talking about Indian bands and Indian musicians and artists going abroad. So let's start with a very, very basic question. If you're an Indian musician, if you're a band or an Indian act that wants to go and play abroad, at what point in your career does that actually make sense? Like, what are the things that as an artist you should have ticked off your checklist before you even think of trying to get a foothold internationally? I think, like, we'll take turns, so everybody start with Leg.
Check.
I feel it's important from my point of view that artists should begin traveling from the early stages itself. It's mainly to sort of learn the skill and to sort of see good music, something which I feel is not happening in India. I mean, don't get me wrong, there is a lot of good music, but there's a big variety of sound which is not introduced to India. So it's nice to have artists go abroad and sort of get that. As far as touring is concerned, I think as an artist, it's important to have the right assets in place before you can actually hope to get any serious, be taken seriously. So I think to have a good online presence, to have at least a few releases, maybe have something to show for, is very important to get, be taken seriously. But I think artists should invest in going abroad and they can easily play shows. There are so many avenues to play shows. So that's what I feel.
It's like correctly said, you have to show for something. You have to show your tours, you have to show your music, what kind of articles have been written about you, who's covering your music, basically. That's one of the main things that outside promoters also do look at for Indian acts, especially.
I'll pass it. I think I'm going to talk from the Bollywood part of it, because there's so much of competition currently in the Bollywood world that goes abroad, and there is a large audience that is there. For an artist, before he goes abroad, he first needs to set his foot in the Indian environment and know that, like how like said, like get your gigs right, get your social media right, make sure you're, you know, seen worldwide. And after that is when possibly you can start approaching promoters and people that at this age and at this time, it's very easy to reach anybody at any part of the world. But before you go and take that step, you need to have that packet that, okay, if somebody even replies to you, you have that, okay, this is what it is, let's take it out. But like I said, now, like rightly said, is that you need to do your homework first before you try and even take it up ahead.
But especially if you're self-funding a tour as an independent act, it comes with a certain amount of financial risk. From what I've been told from my friends who are playing bands, you're generally not going to, you're going to lose money first tour, you're probably going to lose money the second tour. So like, what are the things that you need to keep in mind to make sure that that investment in going abroad and touring will actually have a return? Because I know of certain bands that have gone and played a tour abroad, lost a lot of money, and then not gone back again because it didn't make sense. How do you make those numbers match up?
It's a very tricky question, to be honest. In our case, what worked out was the kind of sound that we have with the Scavengers is very popular in the UK. That's where it developed. And having an Indian angle with a bunch of, we have a very unique sound, so that sort of worked. Having said that, what really worked for us as well was that the first year we had about 18 shows, and whoever booked us really liked the band. And they wanted to book us again. And we had a lot of offers from booking agencies, and we vetted them out. What we did the second year was also to approach some publicists. And that really helped us out, because that's how we got on certain good slots on the BBC, Kerry's Matthews shows, and a few other things. And that actually has helped in laying the foundation for anything that we want to do in the future. Now we do have a good bunch of offers coming in from, especially from the UK market, and from a self-funded point of view, it's actually very difficult. I would say that if you don't have a long-term strategy, there's no point. So,
So for me, my market is mainly the Germany, Berlin, Amsterdam, New York, Detroit, all of that, because we do a lot of underground techno music. So for us, it's a very win-win thing in sort of terms of going there, because you plan it in terms of gig to gig. So you take it, you get XYZ amount for this gig, you get the XYZ amount for gig. So we sort of break even each tour that we do from year to year. So I'd say that it mostly can be very profitable if you plan it accordingly, because if you do it in a proper circle and come back all the way to India, it's a very profitable thing to do.
The artists we work with, generally it's pre-booked by everybody, so we don't have to go and, you know, sell.
Yeah, but so in your case, you're looking at big artists, but you're also looking at massive productions. So yeah, there's obviously a lot more investment in just getting the production done.
Yeah.
So in your sense, what are the financial risks and how do you try and like kind of balance
those? What happens if you planning a such a large concert with a multiple people touring on it, and you know, it's a large production. In terms of what happens with any promoter is obviously gets all the information much in advance to plan it before taking it, even signing the artist. That's how it works on a P&L, and that's how they take it forward.
Yeah. So basically, I'm going to speak from the Bollywood part of it. How Bali said is that being a Bollywood artist like a Pritham, you don't need to worry about finances because you're getting your fixed fee and you're going to do the show. So there's nothing, it's not like thing. But from the indie scene, that, like you said, that you know, it's a lot of money involved. And first year, if you're planning to go abroad, you can make money, but you're not going to make like 100% out of it. But the small things that you can look into are is like Kyle said, like plan your tour correctly. I'm going from one city to another. If you have somebody like, if you can get one promoter to pay you for your flights, then you can tell that, you know, to one promoter that my flights are sorted, you know, can you get me the production? Then, you know, having those contacts and where you can basically abroad is how you get like a tour company to do it, and you do it yourself. It's not like in India, like you take a van, put all your stuff from city to city. But if you plan it well, and if you have the right contacts, that's the main thing. If you have the right people to work with, you can do well. But in your first tour, don't think of making money. Just think of getting yourself known in that kind of industry. And that's where you take it from there.
So I'll come back to you two with a question for now. So last year, I was having these discussions with Spotify and stuff. And like one of the things that they've been really selling as a plus point is they're going to give you back-end data about where your fans are, where your who's listening, where, when, what. So that got me thinking in terms of when you're setting up your shows and you're planning which cities to hit, which venues to hit, how much research goes into trying to figure out where your audience is and how to basically hit as many people as possible. Is that something that you guys are looking at in terms of looking at data for that? Or do you just depend on promoters?
So, like I said, there is a lot of data that you get currently, even from Facebook. One photo, you can tell you who's liked it from where. We do have a team that looks into, you know, okay, if Pritham is putting up this post or this is the song that he's put out, where are we getting? So we'll know a majority of fan base because he's been doing this for about 15 years. So we have that data collected from, okay, you know, this is where I need to go. But we also try to do one city that we know that it's like 10% chance of making or breaking it. But we do rely on a lot of data, and there are a lot of internet, there are websites as well, like you mentioned, that can give you that kind of data. But over and over, we just take it as low, and we kind of do sessions, like social media sessions, where we like put out a post and go like, you know, where do you want us to perform, and then just take it. And then also we ask people who are living there, because they have the better answer. So they'll obviously tell us, this is the cities you need to do. But we, as a team, we always try to do one or two cities that has never been touched upon, that no artist has ever gone, because it's just to open up the market. And we know in that show, we might sell 100 tickets or we might sell 5,000 tickets, but we just take it just to do it for just entering a new market.
Yeah.
So that's how we take it.
So I think it covers most of the point over there.
And so for you guys, when you're looking at, you're doing obviously doing more underground DIY spaces, and maybe you don't have that much freedom to really pick and choose where you're going. But even so, do you use data? And if not, do you see potential for data to help you plan it better, like plan these tours better?
Definitely, man. Research is everything. Without knowing your market, you'd just be shooting in the dark. So for us, it's, we've analyzed all the possible ways like social media and YouTube where our hits are. And also we get written to on social media where people are asking us blah, 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 and we know where the market is. Also at the same time, it's important to reach, initially start with where your music is popular, for instance, you know. It's very important to sort of, for a ska-influenced band, it's important to reach out markets where people will actually like to dance to your music, so to speak. So yeah, definitely research is very important.
Yeah, I would say research is very important, but all inquiries are also welcome from Hong Kong, Southeast Asia, all of that is also welcome because it opens up a brand new market, new promoters, new agencies to work with. And if they do like your music, they're always going to come back to you. It's same with us in Berlin. We've done the same tour for the same people for 3 years. So it's always nice to know that some people over there also have your back and they understand that you're an independent from India, coming to their country, playing for them, playing in their clubs. They love that kind of stuff.
Just to add, I think, adding to what he's saying, developing your own network in areas is also very important because that's where you will get your first break, so to speak, you know, so.
So obviously, you have event fees as a revenue source, but what are the other ways that, as an artist, you can figure out how to maximize revenue when you're going on tour?
For us, we realize that merchandise is a very big method to sort of, we made, normally we don't sell so much merch in India, but we sold out twice in the last two tours in the UK and Europe. So CDs and t-shirts both. There are a few other ways. One very important thing that I'd never ever thought was the collection societies. Especially for a live band, when you're performing in festivals like Glastonbury or if you're on BBC, you do tend to get paid quite a bit. So this is something that we realized we lost on the first year. Then we applied, not having any infrastructure in India, we applied for PRS last year. And we, through some of our connections, we got some of the last year's money backdated. And we saw that there was a substantial amount that actually contributes towards lessening your loss or increasing your profit. Third, it's slightly not legal, but when we advance for the shows, instead of accounting for 10 people, we account for 11 people. And what we do is for sold out shows like Glastonbury, we sell the extra ticket. And trust me, that can be quite beneficial for you.
I mean, we really don't carry any merchandise. We route it back through our website, to be very honest, because we can't afford to take it there, like all t-shirts, slip mats, pen drives. It's not viable for us to take it there.
Actually, that's what we thought the first year, but if you take, say, flights like Air India, it gives you 45 kilos, man. And if you're a band of 10 people, 6 people together, that's a lot of space to take.
In terms of Bollywood acts, obviously you're not necessarily going there to try and like squeeze as much money as possible, but does going and performing in these spaces also open up other economic opportunities for say a Rehman or a Prabhudeva or a Pritham in terms of marketing, in terms of other stuff? Is that something that you also look at exploring?
Now it's going to be we do play like how like said is that you have to be smart about it. So when I'm going to the US, I know I have a ton load of excess baggage. So I will book everybody on a Jet Airways because everybody are those platinum members. So you save that 50 kilos of luggage per person. So that is something that the artist has to give up. And other than that, there's this new fad that's come out that meet and greet. So yeah, you charge an excess amount for a meet and greet pass and you can come and chill with the artist for 10 minutes, take some pictures and all. And then the thing that is to try and find like a local sponsor if you can. So we had a sponsor called Star Bharat and they ran this competition where they had like people coming and posting videos of singing songs, a favorite Pritham song, and we chose one person at every city and they came and sang a song with Pritham. So that gave us a lot of money from that then it was the local sponsor. So try to look for people locally. It may be a caterer, it may be, you know, these people who have hotels, like, so you can give you like something like that. So you can, again, like I said, it's not that being a Bollywood artist, they're going to just give you, oh, you know what, I'm going to book you this whole hotel out. There are obviously restrictions there, but you also need to, as an artist, need to give in and help the promoter that, you know, okay, I know it's an expensive thing, but see, I'm thinking about you five ways. This is where you can also make some of your money back. Because when you do that, that's when he's going to come back to you. It's not, because once you go to somebody and you just rip him apart with all the money, he's never going to come back to you. So there are ways, and I think we do follow that as well.
I think, like as he explained, so what happens is, example, we did a show in Dubai. So during that time, we were trying to do not a usual way where he comes to a press conference and just do a show directly. So we try to create kind of a marketing strategy in terms of for a sponsorship. What we did is we got 1,000 kids, girls to do Maatujhe Salaam, which was it's all over the YouTube and which is a super hit. So which kind of helped us to bring in more sponsors after the entire thing happened, which we did 2 months, exactly 1.5 months before the show started. So which kind of helped us to market really, really well. So those kind of activities we've been trying to do all over now with anything.
Arjun, backstage we were talking about, you were talking about having to deal with labor laws in the US and the union. So like what are the unique sort of technical and logistic challenges when you're putting a tour together internationally compared to doing it domestically?
The thing currently is that the Bollywood market is big abroad in the US, I'll talk specifically of the US, but we don't have like a really like an international promoter like a Live Nation or like a production company like a PRG. So we are dealing with national people who have that love for music, but they don't have that technical know-how. So in the US tour, the major thing was that every arena we did, we were doing ice hockey rings. All of them have their labor laws. And the labor cost is almost double the cost of a production cost, because that's how we Indians work. We work 18 hours a day. And for them, they'll work 18 hours a day, but you'll pay them that much. So I think the technical difference that he had was that because we didn't have somebody of a technical know-how already present there, and they weren't willing to, they will not let somebody go from here and stay there for a month. So the major thing is that we got to know of the technical people like a day or 2 days prior to the show. So to get those, knickknacks, the small, you know, like your in-ears, your mics, there'll always be some challenges that they don't know of. They'll be like, oh, you want 40 mics? I was only told 12. So the major challenge is to get a proper production company. Like today, if you're doing a PRG, you know your whole tour is going to be sorted because they do this inside out, they do it every day. But just the market is just growing there. Like even the promoters there, nobody is going to take a PRG because again, money is the issue. But working with local people and local technical crews, that some of them are equipped to do your shows, but some of them aren't. So there is a lot of delays, a lot of sleepless nights, and you just have to deal with it. But like I said, we're doing a US tour for the first time, and we just wanted to get to that market. So we had to take a hit. We weren't sleeping. That's all part of it. But it's give and take, man.
So Balaji, your shows especially tend to be like very high on production, and you're doing a lot of things. How does that make it complicated when you have to then go and do it elsewhere where you don't have the resources and maybe the backup to count on?
See, what happens is, especially with when we do such a tour outside the country, most of the time when we do that, it's all pre. We do everything in much in advance, like 1 month, 2 months before we go to the country, we do a recce, and we also make sure that we work with the right vendors. And it's as part of our contract, which says clearly saying that we also choose a vendor in terms of such reasons. Also, we as a part of the crew, we have every department has got a certain team which takes over each and every department. So we make sure everything before the artist gets over there, everything sorted 1 month before and cleared. So that's how it makes the entire option smoother for us.
Like in Kyle, so in the case of like indie acts, I feel like a lot of Indian indie acts are a little bit, well, not spoiled, but you take a lot of things for granted in that you'll have backline, you'll have like people will not just fly you, they'll take care of your hotel rooms, all of that. How much of a adjustment is it to then go abroad and suddenly be just like having to deal with all of this by yourself?
A vast adjustment, to be honest. Here, it feels when you come back, it feels like you are really treated well. They really take care of you. You fly to every city. Then you have hotel rooms. You have often it's easy to just book an Uber and get to your hotel. Almost all the shows that we've done in India have always had a backline support and all that. So in that way, we're very sorted here. When you go abroad, it's not the case. Most often, if you're playing festival slots, they don't give you sound check times. You have to just, between 15 minutes to 20 minutes is a line check and setup time. You have to do everything then. It's very important to understand that a lot of main stages will also not give you backline. So what really we do is we do a lot of all the planning in the advancing stage where we work with the festivals, we realize what we have, what we don't have. Then we try and source equipment where in such a way from other stages in the festivals where we don't actually have to travel with it. But also things like we always, you have to, I mean, there's just, everything is very different there, right from how you travel, we book either from a nine-seater splitter van to last year we took a 17-seater minibus, et cetera, et cetera. At the same time, the biggest challenge we have is to choose whether we go for a paid service to expedite or just go for a normal service, in which case, if you're paying for a paid service, it's very expensive. If you don't, then your application is just at the back of the queue, and then it takes ages in a, say, in, during summer. It will take you as long as 40 days to 45 days to get your application processed. So that's actually one of the biggest challenges.
See, for us, mostly we do online business visa because it's a very easy visa. So you already need to just get an invitation from the agency that you're working with. And it's a very quick process. It comes within 4 to 5 days because we do express. We don't have time to plan it before. So we take an express and it comes 4 to 5 days. And once you reach that, it's fine because they just stamp you through. And it's because it's an online business visa, they don't ask many questions and stuff like that.
Do all the markets have online visas?
Yeah, they mostly
even
they
the
do.
UK?
Yeah.
Balaji, so your shows will often have like 100, 120 people. That's a whole order of magnitude of just how do you handle all of that? Just travel documentation, making sure everybody gets where they need to be on time.
So, like as I mentioned though, so it's a larger crew in terms of certain people doing only technical, certain people are dancers, some people are musicians, all over. So it is all on a different example when you start the entire crew starting from the first day till the show gets over or dismantle happens. It's a process of 15 days to 20 days. So they all come on a different timing and different days. So with regards to that, we always pre-plan. It's a set format which we follow everywhere. So it's all been followed in a format where it's all been pre-planned and we make sure that it's all been sorted with the promoter much in advance and confirmed and taken back before we start the entire thing.
I think for visas, you just have to be well prepared and it's, you get it, you don't get it. Like for the US tour, I've had a sitar player who's played all over the world with all the biggest names, but he got his visa denied. So the process that we follow is when you file for petition abroad, we get a good company to do that. And the thing with the US is that when you're going with such a big troop, they want to know exactly what each and every person is doing. So if you put one guy as an artist manager and you put another guy as an artist manager, he's not going to get his visa because they will just straight away say this person is not required as per other things. So you have to be very smart about what you're putting, that, you know, okay, this guy is going to be helping or PA to the main artist like that, because they take that very seriously. And your docket has to be very powerful. Like every document has to be there. It can't be that, you know, you're missing one PAN card. So we make sure that it's a uniform thing for everybody. And we take a biometric on the same day. So even if we have our singers and our whole team, we all go together. So that automatically tells, they already have a thing that, okay, there are 50 people coming in and this is the promoter. But again, like I said, it's up to them. They'll feel something, they'll just say no. So we had about 10 people who had their visas denied. And again, you're not going to spend another $4,000 to file a new petition, which is big money. So, but just do your homework and well, and just give it your best. You don't know if you're going to get it, you'll get it. It's on them, like I said. But if you have all your papers right and you think that everything is fine, you can again reapply and file for the petition again, which obviously you'll get it in. But it's just do your basic stuff well. That's it.
So especially for indie acts, because you're dealing with music like sounds that are more westernized, everyone, when you want to tour abroad, you go to the US, UK, Canada, maybe if you're Punjabi rap or something. But do you think there's opportunities elsewhere, like the Middle East, Southeast Asia, that we're kind of ignoring? I know Bollywood goes there, and I know Rehman goes all over the place, but with indie acts, do you think there are, it's viable for there to be a more of a regular touring circuit, not going to the West, but going elsewhere?
I think the answer is, if you are an interesting act, definitely. It's basically, you need to have a good enough sound that will enable you to get booked in various spaces. And definitely, there's opportunities now for Indian acts as well. However, the issues that we have with visas, it actually sort of differs international promoters from booking you. That is a big thing. For instance, WOMAD tends to book less and less of Indian acts now because a lot of their applications get denied. And a lot of festivals don't have any part to play in your visa application, for instance. It's really, really your prerogative. So for us, especially because we tend to do a self-funded tour, we are not really required to have anything else but an invitation letter from them. So that sort of is a very big thing that I see that works for us. Also, of course, having a good sound and a good online presence and all that, and you can reach out to your markets.
So for I would love to also get the Hong Kong and the, you know, Singapore, Malaysia, those kind of tours, but they also look at, because they also do have a big market, like even Tokyo, I mean Japan, they have a huge market for what we do especially. And it's a very easy thing to do. If you go there, it's 2 hours, 3 hours from Australia, maybe Perth, you can do Adelaide, all of that as well. You can add that into your tour schedule also. But it's a, I would say it's a bit of a difficult thing because they already have their ingrown market and they already have their 1,000 people, their 2,000 people, which are very set, and they're like, oh, this is the artist that I like, this is the only artist I'm going to get to book. So it is a bit of a learning curve for me as well, but I'm sure that now they'll see that there's so much talent coming on because I'm like people like Arjun Vagle and Koran are already going to Japan, playing Boom, playing the bigger stuff in Japan. So it'll open up very soon.
So Balaji, do you like for your bigger shows, are you also looking out for like, do you on the lookout for newer markets or different markets to go and explore?
Yes, we are right now. Example, in terms of like places like Paris and all these places, we've not done a show over there. So we've been constantly looking to do a South Indian artist like Prabhudeva or even Rahman also over there. So we're looking at like multiple places to do something. Like example, there's a Sufi show which has been started now, which has been, he's been doing tours like in a monumentary like. So we're looking at places like that to go all over the world and do something like that. It's in the process, yeah.
We're also looking to do stuff there. Like, we do weddings in Russia, and we have a corporate show coming up in China. So, but to do like a ticketed show, I know there is a market there because China takes a lot of Bollywood in. So they love Bollywood for some reason or the other. But again, like I said, we're still in that process of finding the right person to connect with. See, a corporate and a wedding show is totally different. It's you, the purpose is different. But when you're doing like a live tour, we obviously want to go there. I know we can sell tickets there, but we still haven't found out that right person to connect with. And without that, again, like I said, the whole process of your visas is not going to work out. We can't move from here and just go there and like pitch tent for like 2 weeks and find something there. But we are looking into different markets, and there is a huge market. Like Thailand is now become another Delhi only. People go to Thailand as they're going to Delhi. So it's one of the same things. So, but yeah, obviously all markets are looking for.
So that leads me to the next question, like especially for you guys, when you're a Bollywood act going abroad and playing a show, are you aiming at the Indian diaspora audience there, or are you trying to find like fans and create fans within the local population as well? Like how does that work?
So can you come on in?
I mean, when you're doing shows, say in Dubai or in the UK, are you aiming at Indians or people of Indian origin there, or are you also trying to find a wider audience for your artists?
I think 99% of the crowd we obviously target Indians over there. But example, Middle East, most of the like Saudi crowd in terms of Pakistanis and all the people also we target, but it's 99.9% is more for Indians.
I think we look at the Indian market for sure. That is where the major chunk was. But we also look at engaging the local crowd there. Like we always try to get some local musicians on board. So that always gives that touch. And, you know, generally people are like, oh, wow, you know, there's London Symphony Orchestra playing with Pritham. So that automatically gives, I'm obviously touching another 50 people. They will again connect with another 50 people. So like when we did the US tour, I had a local Nashville choir traveling with me with about 20 people for all cities. And I had a string and horn section traveling with me in all cities. So they automatically started posting stuff. And that automatically, like we had about, say, by the end of the tour, we made about, say, at least good 2,000 new fans. And those were not Indians. Those were like proper local people and from city to city. So we all, you have to look at that in the long run as well. So Indians, for sure, that is where your main market is. But if you can touch the local crowd and get them on your side, there's nothing like that.
For you guys, I'm going to flip that question. But do you think, like, when you, especially when you go to somewhere like the UK, where there are strong South Asian spaces, do those spaces provide an opportunity for you guys to, like, maybe get a foothold or try and do different things than you would do at, say, a normal club gig?
I think it's there are all kinds of events happening in the UK. We've played for the Indian diaspora through, say, a London Mela, but it's very difficult to get Indian audiences to dance to your music, to be very honest. Most of our music has been appreciated by non-Indians, to be honest. Honestly, we are not really focused on reaching out to the Indian audiences so much. But we would like to definitely play to the Indian diaspora. Most of our audiences are and have been so far playing at festivals to the non-Indian audiences. Having said that, the Alchemy Festival this time that we played at South Bank Center had a lot of Indian audiences, and they really, really loved the show. So.
So I think we're kind of getting towards the end of this. I wanted to ask you generally at this point, like, what sort of potential do you see for growth in terms of Indian artists, especially independent artists going abroad? And because I think it's grown quite a bit. 10 years ago, I remember Silent Funk and Pentagram playing in the UK was a massive deal. And at this point, we have acts going abroad every week. But how mature do you think it is, and how much scope is there for this to grow?
Right now, the biggest challenge, I would say, has got to be the visas, man. Unless and until that is sorted and the dialogue is smoothened, it's going to be very difficult for Indian artists to travel abroad. But I feel it's very important for an Indian artist to definitely try to go abroad. There is a big market, bigger market than you can imagine that you have here. Like I said, coming back to the first question, it's unless Indian artists travel abroad, they're not going to be able to sort of open their tastes. And, you know, there's so much music outside that you don't even get to hear here, you know. So,
yeah, that's true. There is so much music out there. You really need to stand out. And I'm sure, like, whenever they go for Scavengers, they do, because Scavengers is such a good band and in themselves, and they do play at all the shows. And I would also say that it does, there is no downfall for me, at least, because we've sort of found our few pockets in the world that we like to go to, and we have a few people over there who trust and believe in what we do. So we link up, but I'd say that you have to really stand out as an artist, even in India. You really stand out, you'll get spotted abroad for sure.
I think compared to whatever the years in the past and right now, what's happening is there's always a new content which is everybody's trying to create in terms of the new artists or a new, like example, like a Prabhudeva. He's never done a tour, like a standalone show. He's always performed as a single artist. Like we are in the process of creating such a new content, because the promoters abroad are always looking for a new content which has not been done. So it is only making us much better for us to do more tours in it.
I think all of them have already given all the points, but like I said, there is a huge market, but you have to have your research done really well before you go for an indie artist especially, and you do have the right contacts. That's the best. Like, if you have an agent or if you have the right contacts that you know that this guy can do something, you can go for it. And from the Bollywood part of it, like again I said, that you have to be different. Everybody's going, trust me, all Bollywood artists going there are singing each other's songs. You will see 5 songs that are there in everybody's set list, but you need to come out with something different. So every time you go even if you go back to the same country, you need to do a different show, a different set list, and maybe different instruments, different singers. But it's growing. There's a huge market abroad. But again, it all starts at home. You need to get your base right, and then you take it from there. That's where you're going to get noticed abroad.
So how important is it to have, like you said, the right contacts? How important is it to have the right sort of promoter, the right sort of booking agent, international booking agent, for you to be able to get these shows? Is it possible to do it without that at all, or
I would say it's very important because venues don't really play any role in giving you shows there. It's not like in India where a venue will book shows for you. They work more like wedding halls where they hire their venue out. The only thing that they do is manage the bar, so they keep the F&B. But generally the model abroad is that there are promoters and booking agents who work with promoters for specific venues. So it's very important to reach out to either the promoters, or in our case, we work with booking agents to get the right shows, you know. Also, it's very important, without which to play venue shows is very difficult. You may be able to hit festivals, but the format that most festivals follow in abroad is no one centralized programming team programs the whole festival. They normally give smaller stages to different promoters, different people who actually in turn take the budget from the festival and curate. Sometimes they just take the money from the F&B that they have within their area, and then they are able to pay the artists. So unlike India, where there is one programming team for one festival, it's very different abroad. So it's just so much to go through. Generally, I would say it's easier to just reach out to one booking agent who then knows the promoters in various stages and is able to give you a good slot in those stages.
So I'd say it's a bit of a struggle if you go directly to the venue, because there's always a language barrier. There's always in terms of a barrier between your cost and actual making your profit. And that's why I think a booking agency or a promoter really helps out, because they know the exact people to give it to. They know the exact club to give it to. They know the exact people to maybe open for your artist, close for your artist, whatever. But I think it's very important, because you need to have that sort of hold over there, and which they have, I don't have over there. So if they have that hold, it's great for me, because all I have to do is connect to one person, or connect to many people at the same time.
I think in our case, it's very different, that we have to work with the right partners, and there are a lot of work goes behind the scene in terms of due diligence, they're finding out who are these people, in terms of what are the business they've done in the past, you know, because it's a large chunk of investment goes in that. And also there are multiple people traveling, and you know, taking multiple license and permission involved in that. Also, when it was such a large format, so as a recovery, you have to have minimum 15,000 plus crowd to do such things. So in terms of behind the scene, in terms of due diligence, a lot of work goes behind for us. So
it's like I said, you need to have your thing. In the Bollywood world, it's there is no like a booking agent, but it's again like when we do a gig in a certain place, we try to meet 10 more people, because you'll automatically get to know, they'll automatically come to you and say that, you know, I am so and so. So you just start talking like this. So that is how, like, from the US, we got a gig in Nigeria because we met one guy and he apparently owns a hotel there. So you just need to network and just talk, meet new people, try and attend as many conferences and stuff, and just get your artists known there. And I think without a booking agent, it is close to impossible, until unless you like have like some really humongous kind of stuff that it's making the world go mad. So it's other than that, it's going to be impossible.
So I'll just ask like one last question, and then we'll open it up to the audience. So outside of the things that we've discussed, what's the like one really critical piece of advice you'd give to an act that is either setting up or going abroad to tour for the first time?
Especially if you're a band, you have to do a daily liquidity planning, which means you need to know in our case, it was a 3-month long tour, so we needed to know exactly how much money we had every single day, based on which on that sheet, if you know that, say, on July 31st, I'm going to be short of money, so you can then plan your payments effectively with promoters and booking agencies. So that way you can sort of lessen the amount of initial investment you required at the beginning of the tour. And for us now, we do a daily liquidity planning every tour.
I'd say the most important thing is to carry something that's from yourself. Like I'd say your music or something that links you to something, because you never know on tour who you're going to meet. You might meet the biggest people, like when we have gone there, we've met the dystopian people and who are big dogs in the German scene and they run their own club and stuff. So you never know who you're going to meet on tour. To carry something of your music, maybe something linking to your profiles or something like that, it's always helpful because...
Yeah.
Do you have any like piece of advice to a musician and artist? Is there also a critical piece of advice outside of the stuff that we've covered, which is logistics and networking?
I think not exactly, but you know, but with such big artists, we always guarded with multiple layers of people. So in terms of that way, we kind of taking care of every single part of it. So, and it's all been every single day been told what has been.
I think they covered everything. Just like to be sure and carry all your snacks from India and be sure that you will not get eat food and you will not have room service 24/7. So it's just prepared to go for war. It's like that. So that's all.
Yeah. So does anybody in the audience have any questions? No questions?
Throw some light on promoting the music out there. No, how do you? What are the channels you use to promote your music once you're already out there touring? And you know, like how Kyle said, you usually carry your music there and stuff like that. Is there any? Just throw some light on it. That's all I'm saying.
So I'd say from India, like now Savan has really started backing all Indian content and stuff like that. So they really do help us with all our EPs, releases, album launch, previews, all of that. So when we go there, it's a very easy link, like a shareable link. From phone to phone, you can do it as well. So that's how we normally take it, because it's a very convenient thing to do.
Do you have any more questions?
Okay, then I guess we can wrap for lunch. Yes.
Thank you very, very much, gentlemen. Thank you very
thank
much.
You. Thank you.
We have a group.